What I want to show you today was a real gotcha relating to entity frameworks. And like a lot of these things, it's actually performance issues, which means you don't get any exceptions or errors when you're developing. And in fact, what tends to happen is you develop with small amounts of data, and so performance isn't really an issue. And you only notice the problem when you go live, or at least go to integration tests where you've got millions possibly of rows of data. So what I've got here is just a simple little people table where we can see we've got names and ages for those people. And then I'm using that inside a ASP.NET Core website. So this is going to be using Entity Framework Core, but what I'm talking about applies in just the same way to Entity Framework 6. So I've got an entity class, person corresponding to what I just showed you for the people table in the database. And then we've got a DB context that just has our DB set of people in there. And then something a lot of people will do is not actually use a DB context directly, but we'll wrap it all up in a repository. So there we've got the repository containing the context. And one of the reasons for having a repository is it means that rather than having all of your client code having to work out its own link to form the queries, we can have just helper functions in the repository like this older, where we'll just get back all the people above a certain age, and then we can encapsulate the actual link inside there. But the key thing to notice is that I'm returning this as an IQueryable of person rather than an IEnumerable. And you'd expect that because a link query on a data source like Entity Framework is going to give you back an IQueryable. Then if you just take a look at our controller, we can see that here we've got an action method called older, and it calls on the repository that older. And then all I do is, having got that data, I just loop through and form up a number of strings to represent each one of those people over the age of 35. And if I run that, then we should be seeing fairly quickly that there we get the list. There's four people in there that are over the age of 35. But if we take a look at the console, we can see that it's configured to output the SQL that's being issued, selecting all the information from people where the age is greater than then the parameterized min age. What Entity Framework does, which is very useful, is does what's known as deferred execution. So if I just go back to Visual Studio and just make that a bit smaller so we can look at the console at the same time, then the important thing here is that if I put a break on there, say, so that's when we get the query back from the repository, and then just refresh the page. We can see we've hit the break, but we haven't yet issued the queries. And if I start stepping through, we don't execute the query until we absolutely need to. And in this case, it's going to be when we start looping through the results. So if I just step into the for each loop, then there at that point, you can see that's where the query was issued. And the nice thing about that is that means that if we then look at our second action here, we've got this count, which does exactly the same query getting the people over 35, but then rather than displaying them all as a list, simply gets the number of people who've met that criteria, and that's what's displayed in the view. So if I click on there, we can see it just says there are four people, which makes sense. But the important thing is if we take a look at what's happened in the SQL, you can see that the query that's been issued has simply selected count. So it's not pulled the four rows into the program and then counted them. It's sent a more complicated query that just lets the database server do the work and count all of them. And this is why I was saying that the performance doesn't show up with a small number, because with only four of them, you're not going to notice that. But if there were a million results coming back, then you would notice a big difference between having to pull in a million rows into the program and then count them up in the program, rather than just letting the database do that and having to send back one piece of information, which is the count. So that's the efficient way to do these things. However, if I make just the tiniest change to the program, which is to say, go back into repository, and instead of having IQueryable of person, have IEnumerable of person. Now that shouldn't make any difference at all, because the IQueryable interface is actually derived from the IEnumerable interface. And if I just hit F12 or go to definition there, we'll see that there's our IQueryable and derived from IEnumerable. And so it's going to be perfectly okay to change that, because given that the link query implements IQueryable, it must implement IEnumerable. And if we then run that up, we'll see that behavior-wise, it's doing exactly the same thing. So we still get our list of four people, and when we click count, we still get a count of four. But if you take a look at the generated SQL, and let me just do that again so we can see when exactly it's happening. So if I just refresh that count page, you can see we're no longer doing what we did before, which was issuing a count as part of the SQL query. We're doing a full select. And so here we're actually doing exactly what we said we didn't want to do, which is pulling in all the rows and then counting them in memory. And that's gone wrong simply because we've changed from our repository, accessing it through an IEnumerable rather than through an IQueryable. It won't just be count, it'll be things like min and max and average and sum, and even things like first or default will exhibit this sort of problem of pulling in too much data and not letting the database engine do its fair share of the work. So the bottom line is we should be using IQueryable here. Just to look at why it doesn't work, we need to look at this count method. Count is not a method on either the interface IEnumerable or IQueryable. It's actually an extension method. If it were a regular method, this wouldn't occur, because it shouldn't matter what interface we're using to access the object. We would be calling the count method on the object, and it'd be the same in all circumstances. But the thing about an extension method is it doesn't use runtime polymorphism in the same way that interface members do. It actually binds statically on the basis of the type of this older variable. And we can see that in this case, it's an IEnumerable. And if I do an F12 on that, we can see, therefore, that that is the count for an IEnumerable. Whereas if I change the repository return type to IQueryable, get the spelling right, and then come back in here, then when I hit F12 again, we can now see we've got the count for IQueryable. So the fact that it goes to different places when I hit F12 in the editor is just indicating that it's a decision that's made at compile time, not at runtime. And the fact is that the implementation of count for IQueryable knows to call the query provider, which in this case being the entity framework query provider, will produce the appropriate SQL query, whereas the one for IEnumerable counts the number of elements it's got in memory, and to do that, it's first got to pull them into memory. So that's why it's so much less efficient that way. So, as I said, the best thing to do, if you've got something like a repository or anything like that, make sure you return IQueryable from it. If you have returned IEnumerable, there are a number of things you can do. Exactly provided for this purpose, we can use as queryable. So on here, if we just say dot as queryable, then that, in this case, will convert the IEnumerable back to an IQueryable. So now if we run that, then go to count, we can see here that it's now doing the correct thing. So it's got the select of count. So if you have got this problem and you can't change the interface because maybe you haven't got access to the code, then we can see that it will work with an as queryable. One thing you might be tempted to do, but I would avoid it, you could also just go for a typecast. So here, we could do an IQueryable or person. So cast the result. And if we run that, and and go to count again, we'll see that that also gives us the correct way of doing it. However, that's not really a very good idea, because one reason we often have a repository is so that we can mock it, so that when we're doing unit testing, we're not really connected to the database at all, we're just connected to in-memory collections like lists or arrays or something like that. And of course, if you're dealing with in-memory lists, they don't actually support IQueryable, they only support IEnumerable, and so you get an exception thrown when you try to cast the list to an IQueryable. When you've got asQueryable, even if you call asQueryable on a list, it does a little bit of trickery that basically takes the list and wraps it up in a very thin wrapper that looks like the IQueryable interface, but then just calls directly to the list. So don't do it with a cast, do it with an asQueryable, but best of all, do it inside the repository, so the repository always returns iQueryable, and then if you're mocking the repository, do your asQueryable call inside the repository, so on the outside no one knows any difference. So that's about it. Whenever you're connecting to a database using Entity Framework, then you want to go through the iQueryable interface, and even if you're in a situation where sometimes you are, sometimes it's a mock, you still want to use iQueryable. And if you do need to convert from IEnumerable to iQueryable, then use the asQueryable method on that. If you have any questions, do put them in the comments section below. And I hope that's been helpful. It's a useful way to avoid some quite nasty performance issues when you go live. And also, it reduces the number of complaints you get from your DBAs about just how inefficient Entity Framework generated queries are.